So in the previous lesson, we had homework for doing these or practicing Express middleware implementations. There were three exercises: this access logger, header reader, and then last, there was this Base64 decoder middleware. And the core idea in all of these was to implement some kind of functionality as Express middleware, where middleware being some functionality which is executed before the Express framework passes or calls your so-called route handler. So middleware can be something which is done before the route handler is executed. The idea was to practice implementing those. Do you have any questions about these exercises? Or did you manage to do those? You can also ask in Finnish if you have any questions about these. Okay, I'm going to try to use now the Zoom polling system. Polling system, so we can see, we take a quick poll that okay. I need to sign in. Let's see. Yeah, this is not so quick after all, it seems. Single sign on. Okay. This is not so quick to create these polls, but let's do so that you can here in the Zoom. In your as a participant, you can put some kind of, if I recall correctly, you can put some kind of thumbs up indication to your participant list as your status. So please mark thumbs up in your status. Or raise hand in the Zoom system if you were able to make the homeworks. This can be used to poll. Few people are marking, so there should be the functionality. I can't seem to find now exactly on my Zoom session that can I put some kind of thumb up or not. Okay, only two thumbs up. Now those are even decreasing. So based on this, it would seem that most of you did not manage to do the homeworks. So if you have any questions, then now is a great time to get some answers. So if you did not manage to do it, then please ask for some help if the case is that you did not manage to do it. Here in the exercise instruction, if you scroll here all the way to the down, there is this piece with small text, which says that if you are unable to do the exercises, the solutions are here. So it takes you to this GitHub repository of Express middleware exercises. So here are the solutions for the two first exercises. So the first exercise was this access logger, where you were supposed to create a middleware to log requests to the API. So here is then the implementation, one implementation for the access logger. Of course, you can do it this in some other way as well. But here we are using the use method from the application. So this means that this middleware will be a application level middleware, which applies to all requests. And how this is implemented is that first a date variable is being created. So in JavaScript, you have this kind of date object, which you can create with new date. And this date object is a built-in object which has all sorts of different methods available. One of those methods is being used here. So date to ISO string. So what this does is that it will give you a human readable version of the current date and time. And then with this to ISO string, what is being done that a string is being constructed. So the string is made up so that there is a date, dash, then there is the request method. Is it a get, post, put, delete? Then there is a space, and then comes the request path, which is then the path where the request is being made. For example, slash dogs or whatever. And there is a space, dash, space, characters, and then the IP address, then again, space, dash, space, and then the user agent, which was used to make the request. So most user agents set this variable, meaning that if you have a browser, the browser name and version will be commonly the user agent header field. So this is here a JavaScript syntax where a string is being constructed. And here the string is being constructed so that it is being used, this being done by using this so-called backtick string quotes. As you can see, the string quote is being done with this kind of single backtick character. Other string characters that you can typically have as a string initializer are this single quote or double quote. The single and double quote characters, they don't have any special meaning or any special functionality in them. They just start and stop a string, single or double quote. But this single backtick string quotation character enables you to use this kind of syntax inside the string. So what this is that it is called, its name is a string template literal. So when you write dollar curly bracket, this starting curly bracket and then closing curly bracket, what you have inside the curly brackets, you can have a JavaScript expression. So here, for example, a method call is being executed, and the output of this method will be placed at this location in the string. Then whatever is that, let's say it's foobar, then the string will continue space, dash, and then space, and then another expression is used here. Again, with the dollar curly bracket syntax, and whatever is the value of this IP property in the request object will be placed here. So this is called string template literal, and you can construct a string from these from the contents of these variables or expressions. That is the idea. Then for debugging purposes, that string is being outputted to the console. And here is then the log writing, what was here in the instruction. So the access logger exercise was that you need to log the requests, and the log should be written into a file. So this part from line 11 to 14 is the one where the file writing is being done. So this FS, Node.js FS module is being used. It has been required here at line 4. So we are using the file system module, and the file system module offers us a method called append file, which allows us to specify a file name, in this case, mylogfile.txt. So it's a text file. And then it allows us to specify some output, what will be appended to the file. So this output variable, which has been created here, so it's a string. So here will be this string will be added to this file. And if this file doesn't exist, this append file method works so that it will create the file. And then this third parameter here is an error handler. Error handler, it's a callback function which will be called by this append file when the operation has completed or if there has been an error. So if there has been an error, this parameter, first parameter, will contain now error information. That's the reason why here is the if statement checking that if the error parameter has any value, then we'll throw the error for the system to catch. But if there is no error, then saved log text will be printed out to the console. Then last, the next function is being called, and the next was received here as a third parameter to this middleware function. And you as a developer, you must remember to call this next when your middleware has finished processing, so that the framework will then pass the execution to the next middleware or route handler in line. So this is the implementation for the first exercise. Then here, the second exercise was this header reader, where it was an idea that you were supposed to have this kind of user information, data stored in memory, and then you were supposed to have this header demo there as a route, which would then be able to process this request with user information also already readily available. And the task was to write a middleware which gives this user information for the route handler. And here was an example of now an implementation for the header demo route handler. So the idea was that you were supposed to have a middleware which gives your info available. And the implementation, that is here. So first here we have the user information stored in an array. Array name is users. It's a constant. We are not going to be modifying the array in this application. So it is created there at line 24. And we have an array of objects. You know that they are objects because you have here the curly brackets. Always in JavaScript, when you have a curly bracket like this, it will either start a method block, code block, or it will initialize a object. So each of our objects will have three properties: ID, name, email, in the same manner what was specified here in this table. So the same data is now here in the users array. And we have here we have the header demo route handler implementation, which indeed does very little. It simply reads the user info property from the request and then responds with that as a JSON to the request. But the main implementation of the exercise was supposed to be done as a middleware. And here we have a middleware function called header demo MV. And it is being assigned here to this route handler. So here you can see a mechanism of how you can specify a middleware for a route handler. So this header demo MV will only be applied as a middleware for this route and not, for example, for this route. Okay, so when there is a request, a GET request to header demo, this header demo MV will trigger first, and then this operation will be done. So here there was a specification that there was supposed to be a header field called user-id. So therefore, we are using the GET method from the request object. So in the Express.js framework, there is this get method in a request object, and it allows you to access the request headers and their content. So we give here the string user-id as parameter to this get method, which means that, hey, give me the header field user-id and its value. The value will be here. Then the value that was given here in the user-id header field, this user-id, it will be used to find a matching object from our users array. So this users is now a global array. It was declared here. For that reason, it is also available inside these functions. So it is indeed global on this file or this module level. If you would have another file in this application, this const, this variable users would not be visible there, but it is visible and available everywhere inside code which is in this file. So from that array, we can use a JavaScript array method find, which is a very handy method. It allows us to give a function which is executed for every element in the user's array. And the idea is that if this function, if it returns true or false, or if it returns true, then it means that we have found a match. If this function returns a false, then it means that this element, which is currently being processed, is not a match. And therefore, the find will continue processing to the next element. So this find method is a very handy method in JavaScript. Of course, you could do this find operation in some other way, for example, with a traditional for loop as well. But I find this find method easier and faster to write, and that's the reason why I have been using it here. So this find indeed executes this given function for every element in this array, this user's array. And when this method, this function returns true, then it means that now we have found the matching element, and the element will be returned from the operation. So therefore we have the user information. This code does not here take into account the situation that what happens if this user ID header is not present, or if what happens if a user cannot be found at all. This only works with the successful case. So this function here, it is being written with this arrow function syntax. And the arrow function syntax is simply a faster way in JavaScript to write a function. You could have just as well written this as an anonymous function with the classical syntax like this. And there could have been that if user ID equals user ID, then return true, else return false. So this single line function implementation has exactly the same meaning as what you could write in this kind of classical function. So this is a function now without a name. So it is so-called anonymous function. And it is very easy to read even for a person who is not that familiar with JavaScript syntax. If he's familiar with any kind of programming syntax or programming logic in general, then the meaning of this is quite easy to understand. Whereas this arrow function syntax is JavaScript specific, and if you are not familiar with the arrow syntax meaning, then this can be quite confusing here. But it only means the same thing what you have here. So it checks that if user ID equals user ID, then we return true. If not, it returns false. And the return statement does not have to be written in an arrow function, as you can see. So this function will return a value even though there is not the return keyword written there. So that's one of the benefits of an arrow function, that you can save writing the return statement. You don't have to write the function there. You don't have to put these curly brackets. So you only write a function parameter and then the function body without the return keyword. If you write it with this syntax, the return is always there. Okay, so when this finds a matching user, it will be stored here, and then the user info is being used to create a new property to the request object, and then this middleware finishes processing. So here we are creating the user info property into the request object, and that is the reason why here you can then use the user info property. If this middleware would not be present, then this user info would not be present in the request object. And this third Base64 decoder middleware, I just noticed that I have not written here a solution. So maybe I will do it for next lesson then, so we can then check it out, that solution as well, if you are interested. Any question about the implementation of these two example solutions? If you have no question, then we can proceed for today's content. And today we are going to be talking about something known as HTTP post multipart. So with the HTTP protocol, you can send these post requests, like we have been discussing before. With post requests, you can send information to the server in different ways. One way is to use so-called multipart transmission. And what is the type of data what you are sending with the HTTP post request? That is always specified in the so-called content type header. So in the post request, you should have this kind of header field present. Content dash type. The value of this header will indicate that what is the data format now in the post request body. So you might remember that all the HTTP requests have the header part and then they have the request part. So the content type header is the content type value is in the header part, and it indicates that what type of data you will have in the body. And this is important information for the server, because without the content type information present in the header, the server does not know that what is the request body data type and format. For example, when you are working with, like we did last week or in the last lesson, we were using this Postman tool to send some JSON data structures, the dog information. So I don't know if you noticed, but when you choose the post method, and then you have here something and then let's say dogs, and then when you specify the body structure what you're about to send, here you can choose these different data formats. And in our case, we selected the raw. And then when you select the raw option here in the Postman, you get this kind of option: text, JavaScript, JSON, HTML, or XML. And when I choose here JSON, what this Postman does now automatically for me is that it adds here in the why is it not visible? It's supposed to add to the header content type. Okay, now it's there. Yeah, so now it adds automatically this content type header field with the value application JSON. So this is what the Postman does for you automatically. But if you were writing now an implementation of your own client code, let's say you are writing an iOS application, or you are writing an Android application, or you're writing, let's say, an IoT application for with some, let's say, maybe you are using C programming language and writing an HTTP post request. So you have to mind that what is the content type field and what is the value? Because if you are using the Express.js framework and you are using the body parser, what we were using last time in our example, is body parser. So this body parser middleware was handling the JSON bodies in the requests and parsing those automatically and then making them available in the body property in the request object. So this body parser middleware, it operates based on the content type what has been written in the request header. If you are sending a post request without the content type set, you might have the body written perfectly fine, but you have not set the content type to application JSON. Then the body parser in the server, the middleware, will not activate. So the body parser middleware totally depends on the content type setting. So that is something what you should keep in mind. So for the content type, you can also have other values than application slash JSON, application slash XML or text. And these were already indicated here, form data, X, www, form URL encoded. So this X, www, form URL encoded is an encoding mechanism, which is used by the browsers when you have a regular HTML form element. So I don't know if you recall or know, but if you're writing HTML, you can have this kind of form element here. And then you can have form elements, which might be, for example, if you are, let's say you have an e-commerce application and you need to, you are making an order and then you need to indicate that where to ship the order. So the form elements, the input fields, are used to receive your address information. And then when you click an OK button, if that part was implemented with a form, what the browser does is that it reads the values from the input element fields. Each input element field will have a field name, for example, email or street address, postcode, city, country, and so on. So those values, those field names and their values will be sent by the browser with this XWWW form URL encoded. So how this would look like is that those key value pairs would appear to your server, for example, like this, that there would be name equals and then X, then email equals text at example.com, and then street address equals something. So this is the format in which the values of the form fields, the names of the form fields, and the values of those form fields will be sent automatically by the browser if the application is using these traditional HTML elements. Then there is another type of form transmission type that can also be activated by the browser. It is called multipart slash form data. And this type of content type is used again automatically by the browser if, for example, there is the functionality to transmit a file. So in many situations, you can, for example, if you are, let's say you are selling your used bicycle at eBay or something. So the eBay application, they might have a button which allows you to select the file. And when you click on the button on the browser, what happens is that the browser will open an operating system specific dialog window, which allows you to browse your file system, go to different drives, different folders, then select a file from there. And then when you click OK, the operating system file selection dialog closes, and then you are returned to the browser where now the browser has received this file. And then when you fill in the other form fields and then click OK or submit or something, then what happens is that the browser will take your file and take your form fields and submit them to the server using this kind of multipart form data format. This form data format or this multipart form data format is very handy also when you are creating, let's say you are creating an iOS application and you need to, as a client application, and you need to send files to the server, for example, or you are creating some embedded application to send files to your API. And it is handy because it is commonly supported, and that means that you can easily find library implementations to deal with the multipart form data file submission, both for the client and for the server. So with the post request, you can send any kind of data. You could come up with your own data encoding logic, data submission logic, and put, for example, raw files to the body. And then in the server, in some way, deal with the raw file data or with some other your own encoding logic. So that is totally possible, and there is no technical reason why you could not do it. But it is much faster to get an implementation ready and working correctly when you are using readily available libraries or framework functionalities to deal with multipart form data for file submission. And that is the reason why here in this course, I will show you an example for the Express.js that how you can deal with this for a multipart form data submission. Because it is indeed a commonly used scheme to send and receive data to an API, binary data, meaning files. And if you recall our graded exercise, I'll open the graded exercise here. So if you recall our graded exercise, where you were supposed to design and implement an API for this kind of platform for selling and buying used items. And one of the functional requirements was that your API was supposed to support receiving images from the clients. So this multipart form data is one way of dealing with this image requirement for the exercise. Okay, so here we have, before going into details of the multipart form data, here we have an example of of what would an post request look like when using the XWWW form URL encoded. So what I already demonstrated in the notepad just a couple of minutes ago, but this is the way here, this would be the header header values, and this would be the body values of the request. So there would be the post method to some route, and content type would be set to XWW form URL encoded. Content length would indicate that what is the length of the body. And then here the body would be in this kind of logic that there is the field name, field value, and character, field two name, field two value, and character, another field name, another field value. So this is the form URL encoded style. Then here we have an example on how does a multipart form data post request look in practice. And these details here are now basically nice to know, because when you are using some library or framework to deal with the multipart form data in the client and the server side, you usually don't have to concern yourself about the details of the implementation. So these are mostly nice to know, but we'll still go this logic through. So here with the same coloring logic, here in the beginning we have now the header fields. And header field of the content type will now be multipart form data. Then what is this in Finnish? This is puolipiste. In English, maybe it's semicolon. And then boundary equals, and then a certain amount of these dashes and a random string. So this is called so-called boundary marker. It is indicated here in the header. And this boundary marker is then used in the body, as you can see here. In the body, it is used to separate the form fields and their data. Here, in the previous example of this form URL encoded, the form fields were separated with this et and character. You see, here we have field two, here we have field one. This is now the field separation character. But here in this multipart form data, we have this boundary marker, which is being used to separate the data. And the specification for the multipart form data goes so that the body starts with the boundary marker. Then we have one part of the data. So as the name says, multipart, this is used to send multiple parts of data. We have one part of the data, and it has its own header kind of, and then its own body, as you can see. So it says here that what kind of data it is now a form data, and what is the name of the form field? It might be person. And this is now the value of that form field. Then when we have a second part of the data, we separate it from this first part again with this boundary marker. Now here we see now an example of how a file would look like. It would have a name. Even if you are submitting a file, the form field should have a name. Here it is secret. Then there is a field which indicates the original file name, what the user has selected. In this case, it is file.txt. Then content type is being specified. Okay, might be text file. And then the contents of the file is put here. Then if we are now at the end of the multipart submission, we have the boundary marker again here, plus two dashes. So this will signify now the end of the boundary, end of the multipart submission. So this is the logic. Here in the Express framework, the multipart implementation is available as a middleware, and the middleware is known as Multer. And here is the description in GitHub for this Multer middleware. As it says here, Node.js middleware for handling this multipart form data submissions, which is primarily used to upload files. And as you can see, this Multer will not do anything for forms which don't have this type. If you have a form of this URL encoded form, this Multer will not process. Again, installation of this Multer is with npm install Multer. And then here we have information on how to use this. And this is very straightforward. So what happens when you are using this Multer middleware is that a body object will be present, and that object will contain file or files properties in the request object. Is it a file or files, depending on the specification, on how you have implemented or called the middleware? So with the multipart form submission, it can deal with a single file or multiple files. If you are using multiple files, then the property name will be this files. If you have other form fields than file types, then the body object will contain those fields, as it says here. Only the files will be present in these two properties. Okay, so then what happens? Here is a client example on the as a normal HTML form. So we are not so interested about that. But here is now an example server implementation. So this is now a standalone Express application. As you can see, it is requiring the whole application, the framework, and then initializing the framework here. And then it is requiring this Multer middleware. And then from this Multer object, or actually it seems that it's a function, what you get when you require. It's a function because here it's called with these normal brackets. So you call the function and then you give a configuration object. And here in this example, this dest property in the configuration object specifies that where the middleware will place the files which it has finished processing with. So here now this uploads folder is specified. Then here is now a route handler which can accept a single file in the format of multipart form. And it is a single file because now this single method is being used from this upload object. This upload object was returned by this Multer function call here. So we use it here as a middleware. So this will be processed before this handler function. We expect a single file with the form field name being this avatar. Now, when the processing or when Express framework calls this route handler function here, in this request object, now there will be the file property where the file information for this avatar will be present. If you want to deal with multiple files, then you can use it like so as an array. That's possible as well. Or you can, here is a third example where you can have multiple files so that they all have in different names. So what this would mean that there is a single request which has a file coming in with the name avatar, and then it has an array of files coming in with the name gallery, with maximum files being 8. Okay, so here we have now an example. And we can try this implementation. If we go on and create ourselves a new folder, PCI Multer demo, then npm init to initialize a new project, yes to all. So now, since we will need the Express and Multer, I'm going to go here directly npm install Express. And once this finishes, I'm going to go npm install Multer. It is also possible to install multiple of these dependencies in a single go like this. I'll do it now here separately. Okay, then I will open Visual Studio Code in this folder by writing code dot. Okay, next I will create a new file. Let it be this index.js. I will copy here all this example code here. Modify it a little bit. Let's print out the request file to the console, and then I will send status 200. You get some kind of response. I can also go here, do the same thing for this photos upload. And now it's files. Okay, let's now start the application and try to send a file with the postman then. Okay, yeah, there's this application listen missing. So we can check it out here from the hello world, from the getting started, that what do you need to do to get the server started. Since this example code did not have it, so we need to go app.listen and then specify a port where to start it. Here port 3000 and then a function call which to execute when the server has started. Let's put here okay. So now it's starting and running at port 3000 at localhost. So let's give it a shot. Now I'm going to send the HTTP localhost port 3000. And then it's here profile. So I'll write here profile. And the body is not going to be JSON, but it will be this form data. Now I can put here keys and values. So these would be now normal keys and values. For example, if I would have here username, text, we could have here email, text@example.com. And then before I click here, this postman offers me here a drop-down selection, which can be used to get the file option. Select files. So now I can go on and submit some image. What would I send? Let's send No, what is this lambda 1? Let's I'm gonna send this file. It's a 1600 kilobyte file. Okay, and now another important part is to realize that what you have specified here, this is now the form field name avatar, so that should be written here. If you don't have this name here matching this part here, then it will not work, of course. Let's see. I got here okay, a response. There it says undefined. Then on the uploads, it says that nothing is there, but now what went wrong? Okay, I have the content type unchecked from the previous exam. Let's try again. Okay, now the content type was selected. Now we get some better response. So here in the console is now the output from this file property in the request. And this file property is present in the request because it is created by this Multer middleware here. So here you can see it's now giving us what is the field name, avatar, like we specified here. What is the original name, lento1, and then some information about the file. Path, here is where the new file is. And here, as you can see, when the Multer middleware receives a file, it will generate a random file name for it. This path now indicates that at which path and which file name you can find the file. So the file will be now in the uploads folder with this EDD 9687, so on, file name. If we now open here, you can see that here it is indeed present. This Visual Studio Code cannot show this file because this file has only a name. It doesn't have any file name extension. So if I put here, what was the original JPK? Oh. Yeah, so now it shows a preview here. So this is the file what I submitted with Postman here. I selected a form data for the body. I have post method request, and then I selected the file. I have this lento1 JPK, which was an image on my hard drive, and I submitted, and my API server received it. Here is the information what it has of it, and Multer middleware automatically then saved it here to the uploads folder. Now, depending on my application, what is the application type? I would now, of course, have here some code to deal with the file. Of course, it doesn't make any sense to have this kind of file receiving if you don't do anything with it. But now I could read the information, for example, this path from the request file, and then, for example, save it into some database and associate that with this user or something else, whatever it is that my application would do. Here, this path is slash profile. So logically, it would mean that we are now creating a profile information or modifying it. If we go here and put so log reg body, we should see now the values of the other fields, what I have here in my submission. So let's test that out. I start the server again so that the modifications what I did here would be reflected, but I did not save. So I'm gonna start again. Send here. Now I get two console statements. So it is an object which has two properties, username text, email text at example.com. So clearly I am able to receive these files, this file and these form fields from the same request. So now I could have some code to deal with all that information. And as you can see, even though I submitted the same image with the same original file name, it doesn't cause any kind of conflict here with the Multer, because the file is here always given a random file name. I need to put it here as JPK so that Visual Studio Code can show it. So here I have the first file, and this is the second file, both of the same content. So if I would like to rename these files, for example, in the code, then I would need to use the file system module from Node.js, or I could transmit them into some another cloud service for storage or something like this. What do you think about this? Does it seem straightforward, or do you have some question that how does it work? Let's try next, so that you'll write your own code to deal with these files here in the same manner what I did. I have an exercise instruction written for that. So let's see. I'll open it that for you. So here we have written exercises. What you can do now here, I think maybe if you do it so that you have 30 minutes of time, so you can have a short break and then do this exercise one. So here the idea is that you would create a new Express API project, and it would have a single path like so, which supports the post request, and it is using accepting multipart request. So this is the exercise task, and I think 30 minutes here combined with the break would be suitable, or what do you think? I will put the links to the chat so you can get the right here. Here is the README for the multipart. Now it's in the chat. So here is the Multer instructions, and then as a refresher, how to get the Hello World application running with the Express.js. There you have a second link. So indeed, the task now is to create your own new Express API project and have it a path/upload, which supports now multipart file upload with Multer. And you have 30 minutes of time, so we will continue about 13:32 to see that did you manage to do it, and discuss about any problems. So please do this exercise. You will need it in the integrated exercise eventually. I will now stop screen share and stop the recording until 13:30. exercise one, how did it go? Did you manage to implement the multipart file upload, or did you encounter some problems which you would like to discuss? Nobody says anything. So based on that, I can only assume that everybody had successful exercise implementation. If that is the case, then great. How about then exercise two? Did you manage to do that as well? It was basically covered in the Multer examples. Okay then, so here I have the code what I had from the example from Multer. So this is the same. So the difference from single to multiple files is here. We have an array or single method call. The main logic is still the same, that here you specify the field name for the single file. Here you specify the field name for multiple files. Here you can specify how many files you want to submit or accept at maximum. So then on the Postman side, if you want to test your implementation, it works like this. So if you have selected the type to be file, so by default it is here on the text, and here the button offers that select files in plural format. So if I choose here, for example, these two images, kuva 1, kuva 2, you can see that now it has two files selected. It's now going to upload two files with the same file name. And the Multer middleware will recognize that. So if I go here and delete all the existing uploads, do I have the server running? Yes. Now I have the path here, /photo/upload, to match this path here. I click send. I get an OK response here. My console output, I get here, you can see I have an array. It's an array because here we have these square brackets. And then the array has two objects in it, which are printed out, these two. So kuva 1, kuva 2 are the original names. And here I have now two files in the uploads folder. So this is the way how you can deal with multiple files. So now in the graded exercise, the specification was that the API should accept at maximum of four files. So that is pretty easy to achieve with this when you specify the parameters in a correct hash. Then in the graded exercise, there was also the requirement that you would have your API designed with the Open API specification language. So naturally, if you want to use the multipart file submission, there is a way how to specify that as well. So here, multipart upload via multipart requests. So when you are describing in the Open API the request body, there is the content. You have to set the type to be multipart form data, just the same way what you do with the Postman. And then when you decide the schema, then it can be an object with the following properties. So this is now the file what is specified. These two properties, order ID and user ID, in this example, these are normal form fields. This file name would now be the file form field type, and the format is binary. The Stoplight IO tool also supports this, so you can achieve this quite easily with that tool as well. When you describe the content type as multipart form data. So here you have how you can do it in the Open API specification when you specify your API structure. So again, relating to your graded exercise, so this is the kind of specification what they should be present in your API specification, and then you can do the implementation in this manner. So I recommend that if you have not yet started on doing the graded exercise, that you would start to do it, and then also start doing the implementation, because now in these future classes we will be going through some implementation details. So it's quite easy to implement the things for the graded exercise while you still have them fresh in your memory, compared to the situation that you try to do everything at the last evening. Okay, then to a new topic called API authorization authentication. So this is quite common thing what you need to do when you have an API, meaning that not all parts of the API should be available for the public. So what you want to do typically is that you want to restrict the API access in some way. When you are thinking about how to restrict the API access, you will soon find out that you are thinking how to authenticate and how to authorize. And it's important to realize the difference between these two terms. So authentication means that you are verifying somehow the credentials of the connection attempt. So this might be so that the client sends the information that who is now trying to connect. And quite common way to do this information is to pass username and password in the request as these credentials. So then the server can check from some internal bookkeeping, maybe a database, that okay, do I have this kind of username and password store? And if so, then it is reasonable to assume that now we are dealing with the user who should have access to our API. And the idea here is that only this one person should know the username and password. So we have to trust on that. Then authorization is something what happens after authentication has been done. So when we know that who is this person, then in the authorization phase, we check that does this person or should this person be able to access this resource or not. So you might have in an API, you might have different access levels. Some routes might be totally public and some are restricted. And for those restricted routes, you might have multiple levels of clearances, so that let's say you have a bunch of regular users who are able to access some of the restricted API routes, and then you have some other users who have higher levels of access to the API. They might be some kind of admins or managers or something like this. So not all users have access to all API routes. And with the authorization, again, you would need to have some kind of mechanism that how to indicate that what is the level of access required to access the API resource. And then you would need to have some kind of mechanism of storing this information per user that now Jonas has level 1 access and Keijo has level 2 and Pia has level 3 access, whatever these levels mean. And then some API route then requires that, okay, only level 3 users can access and not level 1 or level 2 users. So this is the same kind of concept with the authentication and authorization. It's easy to understand, for example, when you think about, for example, access to the school laboratories. Access to the school laboratories, for example, in the evening or night time or weekends. So first to get inside of these laboratories, you need to have this kind of electronic key. And then when you show the electronic key to the electronic lock, it will then perform the authorization operation that checking that, okay, has now this key been granted access to this space or not? And the authentication process is done when you are have been issued the key. So when you are given the key. So typically how it goes is that you will, some teacher might need to send a request to the school janitors, for example, that now Keijo must have access to this lab. And then when Keijo goes to the janitors to pick up his key, he most likely is required to present some kind of personal identification, showing that now he indeed is Keijo and not Jaakko, who is just trying to impersonate as Keijo. So that is the authentication phase, and the authorization then is done by the lock when you show the key. So that's the difference between these two terms. And they are quite easy to confuse with each other. Authentication, authorization, they sound quite similar, are related to the same principal things, but in detail, they have a little bit different meaning. Okay, so then that was the general idea about how to restrict API access. Then some practical implementation techniques. With the HTTP protocol, there comes a so-called framework known as HTTP authentication framework. So an agreed way of dealing with authentication. And when this is in use, what happens is that when the client sends a request to the server, a normal GET request, for example, here, sends this request to the server. If the server has now some kind of authentication mechanism in place, an authorization mechanism for the requested resource, what was asked by the client. And if the server is now using the HTTP authentication framework, the server will respond with this kind of response. It will respond with status code 401, and there will be a header field with this information. So www-authenticate will be the header field name. Then there will be the header field value will be this basic, then realm equals, and then some string. Okay, when a browser, if you're dealing with a browser, when a browser receives this kind of response, it will ask from the user. It will ask from the user a password. And you have most likely seen this kind of mechanism at play. And commonly or encountered, how it usually looks like, we can quickly see from a Google image search, that it looks something like this. You get something like this to your screen when this is happening. So you have written to the browser URL bar some URL address. The browser has sent a request there. The server has responded with the 401 status code with the www-authenticate header field. When the browser receives that, the browser will automatically display this kind of dialogue. And then you will need to give some username and password. Then you click on the login button to proceed. Then what happens is that the browser takes your given username and password and sends a response, or not a response, but a new request to the server. It is again with the get method to the same path, but now with something new. There is a header field called authorization with this value. So basic space and then this kind of secret looking string. This secret looking string here, it has no security mechanism of whatsoever inside it. So this is a string which has your username and passwords, those what you wrote to the browser dialog. It has those in this kind of format. So the username what you gave, colon, password what you gave. Then all this string what has been done, that it has been base64 encoded. And this result is now this value here. So what happens is that the browser will send your username and password to the server in plain text, basically, because base64 is just an encoding. It is not an encryption of any kind. It is an encoding which anybody can decode back to human readable format. So the server receives the username and password basically in human readable format. Then the server checks the credentials, checks the username and password. How this is done depends on the server implementation. Where is it storing the username and password? So it has to go and find to see that, okay, here was username Keijo given. Do I have a username Keijo in my password, in my user storage? Okay, I have a username with Keijo. Then there's going to be a check that does the password transmitted in the request here, does it now match the password what we have stored for Keijo in our user storage? If so, if they match, then the server responds with the HTTP response with status code 200 OK and the requested resource alongside it. If the credentials do not match, then the server responds with 403 forbidden. This is called HTTP authentication framework. And this is something which has been built in to the browsers. And most likely you have encountered, if you have ever seen a dialog which looks like this. The actual UI representation of the dialog, meaning that what is the color and what is the font here, how is this window looking, that is totally operating system dependent. So it is the operating system window system who is doing the presentation of that dialog. This mechanism is not used in very many web applications because the web developer cannot control the UI of this dialog. It looks it doesn't look very nice usually. And as the developer cannot control the UX, then that's the reason why it's not used so often, at least in that kind of manner. But this is called HTTP basic mechanism. HTTP basic refers to this kind of system. So it indeed works so that to be able to access the requested resource, the header field authorization with the value basic space and then username colon password in base64 encoding must be present. And if you do user authentication with HTTP Basic for an API, it means that this header field must be present in every request to the API, where requests to these restricted API resources are done. That is the downside. Another downside is that, as I said, the username and password is transmitted in principle in plain text. So you must never do this with HTTP protocol only. It must always be done with HTTPS. The S in the HTTPS means that it is secure. It is, the security level is quite high. And the HTTPS protocol will take care that nobody between the client and server can get access to the request headers, meaning that they cannot get access to the username and password. This is very important if you ever end up doing anything related to the APIs or anything related to the security. That if you use HTTP Basic, you must never work with HTTP protocol only. If you do, then your application has basically zero security, because anybody can intercept your HTTP requests and extract the username and password from the HTTP headers. And from there on, they can log in to the server with these stolen credentials. So always, always use HTTPS if you are dealing with HTTP Basic authentication mechanism. I hope I have now made this clear enough that always use HTTPS. Back in the days of web applications, the HTTPS was not so highly used and enforced. Lots and lots of services were happily using HTTP protocol only. What happened is that when you went with a laptop, for example, to a coffee shop to benefit from their free Wi-Fi while you are sipping your coffee, and then you logged in to some service, and quite many services were using HTTP only. When you logged into that service on that coffee shop Wi-Fi, anyone else in the same Wi-Fi network could have had a network sniffing program running, practically eavesdropping on every on all the network activity in the coffee shop open Wi-Fi, and there were automated programs which were extracting the usernames and passwords from people who logged into the services with HTTP protocol only. So it was super easy to do. You just had to start up this program, which was programmed to extract these requests and listen these HTTP requests. And in a couple of minutes, you had a whole bunch of usernames and passwords stolen. So that's one of the reasons why HTTP protocol should never be used when dealing with any kind of secure or personal information. HTTP is simple plain text with absolutely no security at all. HTTPS provides end-to-end encryption, which greatly helps and makes possible to have this kind of secure services, what we are now accustomed to. But this is important to realize when you are working as a developer that you should not rely on HTTP only. Okay, we will continue from here from next on next lesson. If you did not manage to do the middleware exercise yet or the Multer exercise, then that is your homework. Otherwise, I don't have any homework to give now. Okay, thank you for listening and have a nice day. Bye.